In today's experiment, we're going to work with the calibration of the thermistor and thermocouple. Thermistors and thermocouples are used in medicine as electrothermometers. Compared to conventional thermometers, these devices have a wide temperature range, starting with the thermistor. The thermistor is located at the end of a metal case in the form of a bead-sized handle. It's small because it is made of a semiconductor material. The resistivity of semiconductor materials is very high, which is why it will be quite enough if we take a small amount of this substance. The thermistor has several advantages, the first being its size. With its help, we can measure the temperature of very small objects, which is impossible to do with an ordinary thermometer. The second advantage of the thermistor is its low thermal performance. This means that the thermistor takes on the temperature of the body or the surface, which it comes into contact with, in a rather quick manner. For instance, when using an ordinary mercury thermometer to measure our body temperature, we have to place it under our armpit and wait for a while until the temperature of mercury becomes equal to our body temperature. However, the thermistor is way faster at this. The third advantage of a thermistor is its temperature range. It measures the temperature from 60 degrees Celsius below zero to 300 degrees Celsius above zero, and with a special order reaches up to 600 degrees Celsius above zero. But before using these devices, it is necessary to program them. A thermistor calibration is its temperature and resistance dependent determination. Since a thermistor is made of a semiconducting material, its resistance will change as its temperature rises. And in today's work, we are going to define this dependence. We can determine the change in resistance using the Wheatstone bridge. The Wheatstone bridge is an electrical circuit used to measure an unknown electrical resistance by balancing two legs of a bridge circuit, one leg of which includes the unknown component. In the circuit, there is an R2 resistance that is connected in parallel with the thermistor. The thermistor resistance is an unknown Rx resistance. And when the resistance of the thermistor is equal to the R2 resistance, there will be no current flow through the circuit. For measuring the current value, we use a galvanometer. The deflection of the galvanometer arrow indicates the presence of current in the circuit. Let's take a look at the Wheatstone bridge. On the handle of the scale, we are able to measure the resistance value. The amplifier is located here. It is set to 1000, which means we must multiply the obtained resistance value by 1000. This button is a key disconnector, and when we press it, we stick the circuit. In the normal position, the circuit is disconnected. Let us start the experiment. First, we need to measure the initial resistance, that is, the resistance of the thermistor at room temperature. As we lower the thermistor into water, its temperature becomes equal to the water temperature. With a simple thermometer, we can measure the temperature of the water and the thermistor. The thermometer shows a temperature of 26 degrees Celsius. Write down these values in a table. Then, by pressing the button, we pass the current through the circuit and see the deviation of the galvanometer arrow to zero. This zero indicates the absence of current in the circuit. Why is there no current in the circuit? Because the resistance of the thermistor and the resistance of R2 located in the Wheatstone bridge became equal. Now you can release the button and find the resistance value on the scale. The scale shows 15. Multiply 15 by 1000 and we get the value of the thermistor resistance at 26 degrees. It is exactly 15,000 ohms. It is clear from the experiment that if the thermistor has a temperature of 26 degrees Celsius, its resistance is 15,000 ohms. Now we need to change the temperature of the thermistor. To do this, we use an ordinary water heater. Immerse the heater in water and heat the water. And at the same time, the temperature of the thermistor will also increase. That is because the thermistor will be the same temperature as the water. Now you need to determine the temperature of the thermistor and its resistance. The temperature of the thermistor is 32 degrees Celsius. Now we press the button. The arrow of the galvanometer goes to zero. After that, we determine the resistance on the scale. The scale shows 9. Multiplied by 1000, we get 9000 ohms. We shall repeat the measurement several times the exact way. When heating the water, we increase the temperature of the thermistor using a thermometer. We measure the temperature. We must wait until the mercury stops on the scale. The column of mercury stopped at 55 degrees Celsius. It is necessary to determine the resistance of the thermistor at 55 degrees Celsius. We set the arrow of the galvanometer to zero, and on the resistance scale we see the value of 6.6. Multiplying by 1000, we determine the resistance at 55 degrees to 6600 ohms. Let's repeat the experiment again. You know, to get a value close to the true one, the experiment is repeated several times. At a temperature of 66 degrees Celsius, the resistance shows 5.2. This means that at 66 degrees, the resistance is 5200 ohms. As we carried out 4 measurements, we got the desired value. Now you need to work on your own. After filling the table with the obtained values, you need to calculate an important characteristic of semiconductor materials, which is called the temperature coefficient of resistance, and is denoted by the letter alpha. In this formula, instead of RT, you will have to put the value after the thermistor heats up, and RO is the initial resistance of the thermistor at room temperature. Delta T is the temperature difference between RT and RO. When calculating alpha, you must subtract the RO value from RT. That is, for example, subtract 15,000 from 9,000. And instead of delta T, take the temperature difference between these values. This way, you will have to calculate alpha 3 times, then calculate the arithmetic value of alpha. Then you must compare the obtained alpha with the theoretical data in your conclusion. That is, you must write the output. The second device which we are going to view today is a thermocouple. A thermocouple is a temperature measuring device that consists of 2 different conductors connected by soldering. As you can see, the thermocouple is connected to the galvanometer using 2 conductors. A galvanometer is a device which can measure very small currents. The principle of operation of a thermocouple is based on the phenomenon of absorption of external energy, which means that it transfers external energy into internal one. The thermocouple has 2 junctions, and when the temperatures of these junctions are different, a current appears in the thermocouple, the value of which depends on the electromotive force, EMF, which appears due to the temperature difference at the junctions. We can determine the current strength using a galvanometer. We use water to change the temperatures at the 2 ends of the thermocouple. One junction will be of constant temperature and the other working junction will be heated. Thermocouple graduation is the determination of the dependence of the current strength in the thermocouple on the temperature difference at the junctions. To heat the working junction of the thermocouple, we must heat the water into which we place this end of the device. It will be convenient to use a simple water heater. As we said at the beginning, when the working junction is heated, the heat of the water is converted into the internal energy of the thermocouple. And when the temperature differences arise at the ends of the device, an EMF arises here, which leads to the appearance of current in the device. After heating the water, we lower the working junction into a glass of warm water and the second cold junction into the water at room temperature, which means that this end will have a constant temperature. Using a conventional thermometer, we measure the temperature of the working junction and the thermometer shows 45, and we need to determine the current value of the galvanometer. To do this, we will use the upper scale of the galvanometer. Knowing the division of value of this scale 2, the division value is 4.5 times 10 cubed. Amperes per division, it is enough if we calculate the number of divisions since there is 4.5 milliamperes of current in one division. At a temperature of 46 degrees Celsius above zero, the galvanometer pointer deviates by 20 divisions. This way, we will take several measurements at different temperatures. In today's work, which you are going to do on your own, you need to build two dependency graphs. The first being for a thermistor, the dependence of the resistance of the thermistor on its temperature. And the second for a thermocouple, the dependence of the current strength in the thermocouple on the temperature difference between the junctions. At the temperature of 58 degrees Celsius above zero, the number of division is 28. Increase the temperature of the working junction again. Even after two measurements, a dependence is observed. With an increase in the temperature difference, the current increases. Let us wait until the arrow of the galvanometer stops. As the arrow stops, we measure the temperature. The temperature is 67 degrees Celsius above zero, and number of divisions is 34. Let us take another measurement. The advantage of a thermocouple is its temperature range, from 270 degrees Celsius below zero to 1500 degrees Celsius above zero. The second advantage is the ability to measure temperature from a distance. At a temperature of 80 degrees Celsius above zero, the number of division is 45. Let us repeat the experiment. Measure temperature from a distance, one end of the thermocouple must be in your room, and the other end near the object, the temperature of which you want to measure. By the deflection of the galvanometer arrow, you can determine the temperature of your object. The temperature is measured only after the galvanometer pointer stops. The temperature is 96 degrees Celsius above zero. The arrow shows 65. This way, by shaping the junction temperatures, we can determine the current strength in the thermocouple. Here, we are going to calculate the number of divisions. In one division, there is 4.5 milliamperes of current, and using this formula, you can calculate the current strength. I is the current strength, N the number of divisions, and C the division price. By multiplying these values, we calculate the current. The main characteristic of a thermocouple is its sensitivity, denoted by the letter K. With the help of this formula, we will calculate the value of K. C is the division price, RT the thermocouple resistance, and RG the galvanometer resistance. RO is additional resistance. Since we did not have additional resistance, it is equal to zero. You can find the meaning of these in your guidelines. N2 and N1 are the values obtained during the experiment, and delta T is their temperature difference. As a result of today's work, you need to calculate the temperature coefficient of resistance of the thermistor and compare it to the theoretical value. Indicate whether your alpha matches the theoretical value. And in the second conclusion, compare the value of K. It will be necessary to build two graphs of dependence. Overall, in today's experiment, we calibrated the thermistor and thermocouple.